Hey guys, I'm Ted, and I'm here to give you another lecture. And for today's lecture topic, we're going to discuss the drive toward the new constitution. But before we do that, I'd like to do our customary recap and sort of re-gauge where we left off in our last lecture. So in the last lecture, we discussed how the United States is now an independent nation. We discussed the effects of Daniel Shays' rebellion in Massachusetts and the fears that it bred amongst the American elite. We discussed the new men, the men from the lower orders, and then the younger men who are moving in to fill the void left by the older revolutionary government, the older revolutionary era's politicians. And then we also discussed the national debt and how that was a sort of overarching theme in national and state politics. Okay, and now that we've covered that, I'd like to jump right into discussing the Articles of Confederation. As you remember, the Articles of Confederation was the first instrument of government, the first constitution of the United States. And the Articles of Confederation established a government with only legislative powers. There was no executive or judiciary branches of the government. Each state was granted a single vote and could stymie unfavorable legislation with a simple veto. Decentralization was the revolutionary generation's way of preserving their own liberty. And again, we were going off of their sense of liberty, which stated that a Massachusetts man had the liberty to discuss the affairs of Massachusetts without the interference of a North Carolinian or the British Parliament. That was their sort of interpretation of liberty, the revolutionary generation government, the revolutionary generation's understanding of liberty. Now, the Articles did function as a legitimate instrument of government with a lot of positive gains. First and foremost, independence was secured and large territorial concessions were made from Great Britain. The lowering of property qualification for voting, frequent elections, abolition in the northern states, and an easing of the restrictions on manumissions in the southern states. The expansion of public education, and perhaps second most importantly, the pattern for Western expansion and settlement was established under the Articles of Confederation. The Northwest Ordinances of 1784, 1785, and 1787 were all passed by the Confederation government, the Confederation Congress. All the western lands northwest of the Ohio River was to be sold in lots of 640 acres. This territory would be broken up into a prospective state once the population reached 60,000, and perhaps even more, perhaps third amongst all the accomplishments of the Articles of Confederation, slavery was outlawed in the old Northwest, in this Northwest territory. And this is perhaps maybe even the fourth, if we can look at it like this, trade was opened with other nations in Europe. Very early on, treaties with both the kingdoms of Prussia and Sweden, the Kingdom of Sweden, they were both signed fairly quickly, and the United States sort of benefited from this foreign trade. And those were all positive gains made under the Articles of Confederation to show that the Articles did function in its capacity as an instrument of government. Now, the Articles did have flaws, and they did have a number of flaws. And the chief two flaws of the Articles of Confederation was that the Confederation Congress, that the national government, had no power to tax. And secondly, they had no armed force. The armed force, the Continental Army, was disbanded. It was disestablished. And a rump force of about 80 men was retained for civic use and national defense use. Again, going back to their fears of centralized power, the states thought that the best way to preserve liberty were to, or the best way to preserve themselves was to simply maintain and equip their own state militias for their own defenses. They did not want the Continental Congress or the Confederation Congress to maintain any sort of large army. If there was a need to fight the Native Americans, and they will fight them as they need arose. If they needed to fight, you know, a European power, then they will simply ask for help either directly to the states or to the states through the Confederation government. But they did not want the Confederation government having an army. And, well, the immediate consequence of not having a standing army by your national government was that you had no respect in international circles. The British very quickly locked the Americans out of their trade system, and they kept their trade post and forts in the Great Lakes, the old Northwest. And if that wasn't bad enough, they also supported Native uprising against the settlers moving in to settle north of the Ohio River. Now, Spain refused to allow Americans the right to use the Mississippi River or to recognize American claims to southern, to the southwest, to what is now Mississippi and Alabama, southern and central Mississippi and Alabama. Those claims were also rejected by the Spanish Empire. Okay, and while all of this is going on, we still have the rather unique situation of slavery in the South. As we've been tracking, slavery is still a recurring feature in American history, and in this era, it was kind of a dynamic. It was a very interesting phase in American slavery. So in the Upper South, slavery was retained, but manumission was made much easier. In the first decade after the Revolution, Virginia slave owners alone freed upwards to 10,000 slaves. But a major factor for the shift away from intensive slave labor in Virginia was the decrease in the importance of tobacco to the Virginian economy. After the war, it was just simply economically unviable to Virginia slave owners to maintain any number of slaves, really. They were simply losing out, especially the smaller slave owners holders, but also a number of the larger slaveholders. The situation wasn't quite the same to Virginia South. The long staple crops of rice and indigo, and in particular we're talking about South Carolina, the long staple crops of rice, indigo, and the burgeoning but increasingly lucrative industry of cotton were very profitable to them, but they required a very large and inexpensive labor force that could be subjected to work under harsh conditions in the disease-ridden swamps. And to the elites, slavery perfectly suited that need. However, the major drawback that they found was that in maintaining a large slave class, fears of slave uprisings ran rampant amongst the slave owners, and this led to a stricter and more broad, broadly confining slave codes. It also led to the increased policing of both slave quarters and also freed people's quarters in these cities and even in towns where freed people live. There was always some sort of inspection going on. There was always some sort of oversight by the state elites. Also, there was this general sense, at least from the elite's point of view, that anarchy was about to break out in the new nation. By the mid-1780s, the state governments that had rewritten their constitutions in the heat of the moment in the 1770s, they were pretty much finding those constitutions and those governments unbearable. In the heat of the revolution, they created governments that were populist and unicameral. And after the revolution, they found that those governments simply didn't suit their needs. The governments that they created had a weakened role for governors and judges to reflect the anti-authority sentiment of the time. The judges were elected, not appointed, had they had been done by the colonial governors and by the crown. The judges could also be recalled for, you know, any reason, any sort of perceived violation of liberty. And popular majorities held sway. And those two factors, the popular majorities holding sway, the instability of the courts, and the relative weakness of the governors, it was all just one giant recipe for a disaster. The popular majorities are not always wise. Timid governors are bad for everybody. And of course, judges who kept their eyes on re-election and were always in fear of being recalled are likely to be susceptible to, one, bribery, and second, fiscal control. And this sort of, and at first, you know, on paper, this all pretty much just echoed what they wanted in the first place. They created the same type of the ideal government they wanted during the colonial era. Now, all of these events coming together created a certain type of political climate for the new republic. Balanced government, as we've been noting, was rejected overwhelmingly in favor of a government that had supreme legislative power. Now, the move to a written constitution was a very conscious effort to echo the colonial past. All throughout the colonial history, going all the way back to the Mayflower Compact and the fundamental laws and orders that established Connecticut, there had been a document that stated what will and what will not happen in this new polity. That was continued with the Articles of Confederation, and it will continue on as these men begin to drift towards crafting a new document to govern the new nation. Now, the states retained their distrust of centralized power. They had no real history of cooperation. The cooperation that had developed during the struggle for independence broke down almost immediately after the war was over. The smaller states, of course, feared the ambitions of the larger states, especially in regards to Western land claims. Western land claims were chief amongst the reasons for distrust amongst the states. Primarily, the fear of smaller states and also just even larger states that didn't have land claims was that the smaller states and then also the states without land claims, their fear were pretty much based on them losing their populations to larger states who could avoid taxing their citizens because they would simply utilize land sales to fund their governments. Sort of an echoing of what happened during the colonial era. We saw that the colonial elite did not like to tax themselves. They simply generated all the funds necessary and the funds needed for ordering their government through land sales. This became a pretty deal or no deal moment during the ratification process for the Articles of Confederation. For one, Maryland refused to ratify the Articles until all the states with Western land claims ceded their claims. They would do so. Not all of them did so all at once, and some of them would go back on their word and simply restate their claims. But for the most part, they did. Virginia, leading the charge, relinquished a lot of its land claims, but they relinquished them to the national government, again, to the central government. Now, while all this is going on, you still have the events of Shays' Rebellion sort of popping up You had the fierce, the memories of Shays' Rebellion popping up. You also had this sort of new definition of liberty coming from the elites. The elites were holding on. The elites had crafted this new definition of liberty, one that was always sort of on constant guard from mob rule or what they labeled the threat from below. There was a very prevalent idea amongst the elites, amongst the money class, that liberty can most certainly be threatened from below. Shays' Rebellion, again, played a major factor into that. Here you have people from what they would consider the lower order of society threatening to topple one of the states. And if it happened in one state, it can happen in another. John Marshall, future Supreme Court Justice, he has a quote that pretty much summed up their fears. He said, I am an aristocrat. I love liberty. I hate equality. And at that moment, the elites decided to shift from decentralization to centralization. At this moment, centralized power became the new political nexus. It became the new political focal point. It was now necessary. And to sort of spearhead all of this, there was one event that sort of encapsulated the entire movement of the elites and coming together to sort of guard from below. Virginia and Maryland in 1785 signed an agreement regulating the use of the Potomac River. The Potomac River is shared by both Virginia and Maryland. The Confederation government had no right to delve into the affairs of the states, so it was up to Virginia and Maryland to sort it out for themselves. They had done so, and this sort of spurred Congress to compel the other states to, on their own, come to an agreement on such matters, on interstate commerce, and also the shared use of waterways. A few states decided to hold a convention in Annapolis, Maryland, to settle disputes over the Susquehanna and Delaware rivers. Maryland, Virginia, Pennsylvania, New York, and New Jersey attended. Alexander Hamilton, who had been elected to the New York State Legislature, managed to grab for himself a spot as a delegate to the convention. And he, along with the others, managed to persuade the convention that the interstate problems would persist unless they were settled at the national level. So the Annapolis Convention was then dissolved, and its members then determined and were encouraged by the more fervent promoters of this idea. They were encouraged to go to their states and call on their states to inform their representatives in Congress to call for a national convention to revise the Articles of Confederation. At this point, with the intention of protecting themselves from the threat from below, to guard themselves from the anarchy of the mob, they were now calling for a convention to guard, to revise the Articles of Confederation, not alter. This convention was not to alter, not to abolish, not to create a document that would supersede the Articles of Confederation, but simply to revise it and to make necessary improvements to the document. And they did so. They were able to successfully lobby in their states, and their states were able to convey the message to its representatives in Congress. And the Confederation Congress organized a convention of delegates and sent them in May of 1787 to answer. They had them go to Philadelphia, and they had them devise. They had them devise a. They had them devise answers that shall appear to them necessary to render the Constitution of the federal government adequate to the exigencies of the Union. And with that, we'll break. We'll break because the next lecture is going to discuss the Philadelphia Convention or the Constitutional Convention itself. But for now, before we go, I just like to wrap it all up by saying that the Articles of Confederation, it had its successes and it had its failures, but it served its function. It was not designed to be a great national government. It was designed to function, to allow a national government to function while leaving the majority of the power, the bulk of the power, to the states. This entire era, post-revolution, it marked a new era in politics. There was a lot more activity from the laboring class, from the middle class. There was this sort of rise in what's acceptable and what's not acceptable for the nation. And to the people below, to the people rising, it was all good for them. But for the people who were on top, they were very conscious about who was participating in the new government with them. And with that, I'll end here. And I hope you guys enjoyed the lecture. And I'll see you guys for our next lecture. As always, I'm Ted. Hit like, subscribe, and comment.